The account of Jesus' ascension is recorded in four different places in God's Word, in Matthew's Gospel, in Mark's Gospel, in Luke's Gospel, and then also in the book of Acts, the first 11 verses of the book of Acts. This is an attempt to compile and harmonize all of those four sections into one account that has all of the details of Jesus' ascension. It's a little bit longer account, but it does give us the account of Jesus' ascension back into heaven. Luke writes, "In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. Soon after the resurrection, the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age.' On one occasion, Jesus said to them, 'This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms.' Then he opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures. He told them, 'This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead and on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things.' On another occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: 'Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit.' Then they gathered around him and asked him, 'Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?' He said to them, 'It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth.' When Jesus had led them out to the vicinity of Bethany, he lifted up his hands and blessed them. While he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up into heaven before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight, and he sat at the right hand of God. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside him. 'Men of Galilee,' they said, 'why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus, who has been taken from you into heaven, will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven.' Then they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy from the hill called the Mount of Olives, a Sabbath day's walk from the city. And they stayed continually at the temple, praising God." This is the word of the Lord. God's grace and his mercy and his peace all are yours through the merits of Christ Jesus, who is God's Son, God's risen and ascended Son, and our Savior. Amen. Our text for this morning on this ascension that was actually on Thursday night, 40 days after Jesus rose from the dead, but we're celebrating it on Sunday as well, is taken from basically that harmony of the ascension that we read earlier, but focusing specifically on a couple of verses from Luke chapter 24, and these are the verses especially that we'll be taking a look at. Luke chapter 24, beginning at verse 50, "When he had led them out to the vicinity of Bethany, he lifted up his hands and blessed them. While he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up into heaven. Then they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they stayed continually at the temple, praising God." This is God's word. May we always learn and benefit from that word of God. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, our risen and ascended Lord and Savior, back when I really didn't have any time for country music, there was a man called Garth Brooks who kind of broke onto the scene in the early 1990s, And he became one of the most popular modern day country singers that our country has ever seen, Garth Brooks. One of the very first hits that he ever sang, and I don't believe it was his writing, someone wrote it for him, was called "I've Got Friends." Yes, in low places. And it was a hit. You could not go anywhere without hearing that song. The radio gave it all kinds of airtime. Everybody knew the chorus, might not have known the verses, but everybody knew the chorus. But I always kind of wondered what he was talking about or what the songwriter was talking about when he wrote those words of that chorus or that refrain. I've got friends in low places. Is that a good thing or is that a bad thing? I suppose it can be a good thing if you want to have fun, but I've always been under the impression and I've always heard that it's nice to have friends in high places. Isn't that right? Because if you've got friends in high places, then you might have someone with the power or the authority or the influence that if you know that person, they can kind of say, you know something, come on over to this company. I can get you a foot in the door, and then who knows where you'll go after that. It's good to have friends in high places, people who are willing and able to use their name or their authority, or the position that they hold in whatever job that they have, that they can kind of help you. It's same thing as the phrase, it's kind of who you know, right? And where those people are that you know. The ascension of Jesus, which is, again, so often a forgotten festival because Christmas celebrates Jesus is here. Easter celebrates that Jesus' work has been accomplished. It is finished on Good Friday, and he rose again, sins forgotten and sins forgiven. But ascension also gives us a truth, and that is the fact that we have a friend in a very high place. We have a friend who does use his power and does use his authority and does use his influence to help us who are still on this earth. He is still ruling for us, for our behalf. He is still interceding between us and his Father and our Father in heaven. He is also preparing a place for us. And so therefore, I would say that it's always good to have friends in high places, as well as it might be good to have friends in low places. And that's what we're going to use as our theme for this morning, that we've got a friend in a very high place, and his name is Jesus. And he has ascended to the right hand of God, where he continues to work on our behalf. He has not forgotten us as he has gone back in heaven. When you read through that account of the ascension, there's a couple of verses that might strike you as a little bit strange. And those are the verses that I just read before from Luke chapter 24, starting at verse 50, where we see the disciples' reaction after they were up on top of that mountain, and they basically said goodbye to Jesus for the last time. No more would they see him. They had seen him for 3 years. They had been with him, gotten to know him very well, gotten very close to him, but now they would see him no longer. So what was their reaction? Well, they didn't complain. They didn't go through the stages of grief like sometimes people say that you go through after you've lost a loved one. They didn't go through the anger. They didn't go through the bargaining stages. They didn't go through any of that. They didn't complain that their teacher, that their best friend, had been taken from them back into heaven. They didn't fall into a deep depression. They did none of that. So what did they do? What was their reaction after Jesus had said goodbye and lifted up his hands, blessed them, and basically gone back up into the sky? This is what they did. They worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they stayed continually at the temple praising God. Isn't that a strange reaction when you say goodbye to someone that you love? They returned to Jerusalem and they were happy. And they were joyous, and they stayed continuously at the temple, and they worshiped God there. Usually the only goodbyes that we are kind of happy about is when you're stuck in a conversation that goes on and on and on, and you're desperately trying to get out of that conversation, and finally when you can leave that conversation, you say goodbye, And that's a good thing. Or when you're stuck in a situation that you don't especially like. Very often you go to school for 8 years and then your parents tell you, yeah, you got another 4 years after that in high school. And some people as a senior in high school, 17 or 18 years old, they say, you know what, I am done now. And when they say goodbye at their graduation to the school that they had just spent 4 years at, they are filled with great joy. And they would be praising God for the fact that they were done. No more school whatsoever. But that's not the way those disciples reacted. When people who love each other, people who care for each other, they take leave of one another, how do they typically react? Moms cry when their children go off to college and they're not going to be seeing them every night for supper or after school. That's how moms are. Children cry when mom or dad gets sent or deployed overseas for a certain amount of time because they know that they're not going to see mom or dad for months, sometimes years at a time. Dads try to hide their emotions very often because they don't want to say, you know, something goodbye. And so they kind of hide their emotions. They try to keep their emotions in sometimes. But not those disciples. They were happy. Again, they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. They stayed continually at the temple where they praised God. Where did the joy come from? Where did the happiness come from? Where did the motivation to praise God come from after they had just seen their best friend leave them for the last time? Because they knew and they know what we know when we confess in the Apostles' Creed and the Nicene Creed and the Athanasian Creed, for that matter, that Jesus has ascended back into heaven and he is seated at God's right hand. And they know what that means, the fact that Jesus has ascended back into heaven and is done with his mission. Jesus had come to this earth for one purpose and one purpose only. And it was not to give us a good economy, and it was not to make you rich or to make you happy, as so many people say, this is the purpose of Christianity. This is the purpose that Jesus came. No, Jesus came to this earth for one reason, and that was to save you from your sins and to take away the punishment that is duly ours because of our sins and to tell his Father, I will do this because I love them. With his blood, with his redemption on the cross, by giving his blood for us and giving his body into death, Jesus paid for our sins. And it was proven that was the payment for our sins accepted by God when he was raised from the dead on Easter Sunday. And so now, heaven, which was once closed, is now open to all who believe. Because Jesus broke that barrier wide open once and forever. Once and for all. And having finished now what he has done and came to do, now he could go back to heaven, not to sit in his lounge chair and enjoy retirement as people so often look forward to after many long years of hard work. He's back in heaven, but he's working just as much in different ways as he did when he was on this earth. And those disciples now knew that they had a friend in heaven. Yes, they knew that his presence was with them on this earth, but they also knew that they had a friend in heaven who could do a lot for them, who could be what he said he was going to be for them. This is what Luke writes. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." And then he opened their minds so that they could understand the Holy Scriptures. They were getting it. They were getting it clicking in their minds. They were starting to grasp what Jesus really had come to do. The other gospel writers, when you hear in Matthew's and Mark's and John's account, they sometimes talk about the fact that they remembered what was written in the Old Testament, and then they kind of got what Jesus was getting at or doing. Luke uses a different phrase. He talks about being opened their minds being opened, the scriptures being opened, their eyes being opened. When Jesus sat down with those two Emmaus disciples, remember, on their way to Emmaus, they walked for 5-7 miles, and they sat down after a long, dusty trip, and Jesus broke the bread, and what does Luke tell us then? Then their eyes were opened to see that the guy who had just been opening scriptures to them was in fact their Savior, Jesus Christ. In these words, right before us in Luke chapter 24, their minds are opened when Jesus is talking to them, to the point where they can say, now I think I'm starting to get why Jesus was here. He was not here to be the king. He was not here to establish an earthly kingdom. He was not here to be my always here best friend. He had done what he had come to do. The job was completed. Now he was going back to heaven. And you'd think that this would be an occasion for sadness that he was leaving them now, but it was just the opposite. The one who came down from heaven because of his love for us sinners now ascends to heaven, back to heaven, with the same kind of love that he had for us and shows the same kind of love still today. The one who subjected himself to the frustration and the sinfulness of this world now has risen back to heaven and rules over all of this world for our good. The one who rose from the dead to break the power of death is now in heaven, and he's preparing those people who go through death for an eternity in heaven. And those disciples got it, and they knew it. And they rejoiced in the fact that they were getting it, that God was opening their eyes for them and their minds for them. And they rejoiced the fact that they had a friend in high places. And so do we. We don't say, I can't believe that Jesus has left us, because Jesus has said, I am with you always to the very end of the age. This goodbye was not a time for tears. It was a time for joy, and it was a time for praise, and it was a time for happiness. Jesus might have ascended into heaven. We don't see him on this earth, but he is as close to you as he ever has been. His ascension is not so much a, I will not see you again, as it is, as the Germans say it, Auf Wiedersehen. I will see you again. And until I see you again, bye for now. Just for now. Friends in low places, they might be a lot of fun. You might have friends in low places. You can have a lot of fun. But if you're talking about an eternity that's going to last for longer than the 50, 60, 80, 90 years that we have on this earth, I would much rather have a friend as Jesus is in high places. That's what we need, and that's what we have. The ascension of Jesus, which has largely kind of been forgotten by the whole world, was always one of those major celebrations and festivals of the church, and for good reason. We don't have a God who is far away, retired, not doing anything for us. We have a God who is up there, and he is working for us. Again, ruling on our behalf, for the whole world, making things work out for our good. That's not just some pie in the sky notion. That's God's promise to us, that everything that you go through in this life will be worked out for your good, your eternal good. We have one in heaven, a friend in high places, who is interceding for us on our behalf. So when we do mess up and when we do sin, Jesus pleads to his Father on our behalf, saying, remember my death on the cross to pay for all of those sins. And we have one who says, I've got a mansion up here, and it's filled with little mansions that are ready for you, and I am doing just that, preparing each one for you. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. Enjoy the blessings that come from having a friend as Jesus in heaven. Amen. The peace of God, which goes beyond our understanding, will guard and keep your hearts and your minds in the true faith in Christ Jesus. Amen.